Check it out. AMT's 1969 Yenko Chevy Camaro in 1/25th scale. This kit's got some cool options, is it? It's released again for you to take a look. We'll see what's everything's in the box. Let's get the body out there. Let's get the chassis out there. We've got a good amount of styrene, but not a huge amount of parts. It's not an extremely advanced kit. You can see it's got a lot of the suspension molded in. We've got that nice one-piece underbody, which will facilitate exactly what I want to do with this kit, because I have a plan for it, and I hope you like it. We got the interior tub here. It's actually a really heavy piece of plastic on that interior tub. I'm surprised. Nice door molding. Still holding up. I don't see a lot of flash on anything. There's our nose with our spoiler and our little fog lights already in there. All the way around, we've got our Camaro logos. We've got our side vents there. All the way around the back. We got our taillights molded in. We just need to put the rear pan on. So that's the body. Let's get the other styrene goodies out. You'll see that there are options in the kit. It's not just a build it one way. You can build it a couple different ways. We've got some lake pipes here, some side pipes on this tree. We've got a rear spoiler with a nice shape to it. Should be able to glue onto the body relatively easily. We've got what looks like our rear pan here and some large mounting points. Should push in nicely. Two different steering wheel options on the kit right there. Stock and aftermarket. We've got the Camaro bucket seats. We've even got headrests with pins for them. The rear suspension and driveline and exhaust are all one piece. And that is the older kits were done this way very often to simplify molding and assembly. Doesn't bother me at all with what I plan on doing. We've got a nice dashboard here. Still got good detail on there. The molds are still sharp. You should be able to enhance that easily. We've got a gorgeous cowl induction hood that is really sharp looking, and it does have a lift on the bottom as well. So it's not just one-sided, that is sharp. We've got our manifolds. We got a separate battery. We got some hints to the older age of the kit there. We got our heads, intake, block and transmission halves, water pump housing, belts and pulleys on that tree. On this one, we've got the optional hood here with the different hood louvers. Underside is also correct. We've got a convertible boot. I don't understand that one. Someone fill me in. Must be a convertible version, or you can hack this down. You can cut the body into a convertible if you wish, I'm guessing. We got a nicely detailed firewall there with heater box and everything. We've got our two wheel backs. On this tree, we've got our radiator surround, and we've got some wheel pins. Do not lose those. And we've got a center console, and it looks like an air cleaner on there for a two carburetor system. Let's go to the other side of the table. Put out one of the most favorite things you'll always find in AMT kits are the wheels and tires. This one does not disappoint. We've got a set of BF Goodrich radial TAs, says it right on the side. Feel free to bring those out. They are pretty prominent on the sidewall with a white chalk pen you've seen in other videos, and that correct radial TA triangle style tread pattern. Used to see those all the time. We had to change them on the Little Red Express almost every month. Goodyear Polyglass GT, gorgeous white letter tires. These would be your factory stock tires. Nice tread pattern, excellent pad printing, nice soft hollow tires, and black wall on the other side. Those are awesome. On the chrome tree, we've got clear parts, we've got red parts, we have a single metal axle in the box. Our clear red parts look nice. Those will fit nicely into those taillights, and we'll be able to detail around those. You can see the detail is prominent. We've got our back, front, and headlights. Nice glass on there. Not super distorted. Nice thin styrene and clear. And we've got our grille with headlight buckets in it. That'll be easy to black out. We've got our very thin bumpers molded in and chromed. Two sets of wheels for those different style tires, wide or thin. air cleaners, carburation. We got a dual carb intake there, oil pan, valve covers, fan. We've got a nice set of selection parts and some stuff for the extras box. And to wrap up everything in the box, we've got the Yenko decals. We've got them in black, and we've got the exact same decals in white if you can't see them. We've got factory badging. We've even got a window sticker in this one. We've got gauge cluster to make our lives a lot easier under the hood. We got the 427 logo for the air cleaner, Camaro badges, Chevy badges, and numerous license plates to take a peek at. All right, I'm going to start getting some things assembled. I've got a special plan for this, so we're going to get it assembled. We're going to talk about that in a second. Very quick assembly and some doctoring of the body and other parts. Let's look at what we're going to be doing. First, your hint about what I'm going to be doing with this build. I've cut the driver's side exhaust off the vehicle except for the final muffler, the resonator on the back, and the pipes. So you can see that sitting there. That will be painted and detailed as one piece and installed. You can see the exhaust sitting here as its own piece that I cut free, and you can see the drive shaft sitting as its own piece that I cut free. So yes, we're going to be doing this as kind of a derelict vehicle. We've got the belt, pulley, and alternator system all set up, press fit, push together. We can get that painted up a base color. The firewall and the radiator shroud will get painted up on their own, along with the rear cowl that pushes in from the back. We'll get that in. We've got our steering wheels here. The only reason I didn't cut them both off was that I haven't decided which one I want to use, but they'll get painted the same color and installed whenever we feel like. On the front wheels, if you don't want your car to roll when you're done, feel free to glue those pins in. Otherwise, just press fit them in so that it is a friction fit when you get it into the car. The dashboard will be painted up, and then we'll get the decals on that right away so we can start doing some weathering. I've got the seats set up. I got the driver's seat with its headrest. I left the headrest off the passenger seat, and I've got some ideas for that, so I'm gonna paint them on the tree. We'll come back during the painting section. You'll get to look at what I wanna do with those, at least trying new ideas and having fun. The hood is set to go. The battery, the manifold, one of the manifolds is on, and the radiator hoses are right there. We can get those all painted up and detailed later. We've got the engine here. We've got most of the engine assembled. We've got the oil filler on. We've got the water pump housing on. Oil pans on it with that one-piece shield. We've got the one manifold on with the one cylinder head. We've got the intake on it with no carburation or distributor in it, but the holes are left open, same as the radiator. We've got this side. Now, don't worry about the arrangement of these holes. Only worry about the one open hole. All right, we're going to get this painted. I've got the cylinder head separate, so we're going to get this painted up and do this in the vehicle as a certain look, and we'll get onto that normally, but don't go, well, actually, these aren't the correct position for the cylinders. It doesn't matter. Just pay attention to that one hole there that I drilled with a drill bit. The brand of the drill bit doesn't matter, folks. Just drill a hole in there. We got our center console ready for paint. We've got our chassis ready for paint. We can do whatever we want with that to beat it up a little bit. On the chrome, I'm going to be dull coating all the chrome and throwing a little bit of rust on some of the chrome. What I've done is taken silly putty on areas that I want to still stay shiny, like one of the headlight bezels I filled with silly putty, two of the back wheels, the wider wheels I filled with silly putty, left everything else open and exposed so that I can decorate it as please, and I won't have those areas touched. The interior is ready to go. We're just going to stick that down to the panel and get that painted. Now we've got the body. The body is set. I can put it on my stand and start painting. What I did was I wanted to enhance a few details on it. We got a dent there in the bottom of the door, very common area for a dent. And we've got just a little minor dent in the front fender. How did I do that? Extremely easy. I asked some friends how they do it. All different kinds of opinions on how to get it done, but usually the best way to do it is with heat. So I use this nice little mini torch, hold it underneath, quite a ways underneath, and let it warm up. And now this dent on its own just sunk itself in. That one, because the side's quite thin, it pushed itself down. This dent here, because the plastic is much more thick on the fender, when I held it underneath, I had to push in with my finger. The only problem being is I warped the inside of the fender a little bit. I don't care. What I did was I shaved that down with a knife so that it's level with the hood. We'll just call it another dent because it does go down in nicely on the fender there. So we're all set to go. We've got a little bit of body damage to the vehicle. Now I'm going to go over to the paint area, start getting my base coats on. I'm going to base coat the body, pre-fade the body like you know I like to do. I'm going to flat coat the chrome that I want to flat coat, and then get some other little additions to that as we go. And when we come back, we'll be in the painting section. once we do all the basic paint work, now, as I've done in many other videos, every time I beat up a model, is I will just start doing my dry brushing, surface work. I will finish off the interior and dirty it up. I will take some gloss coat and coat the back seat. I didn't crackle the back seat. They don't usually crack nearly as bad as the front seats that are exposed to more sun. You can see that crackle effect on there. I think next time I attempt this or experiment with it, I will do a little bit less of the crackle effect, though these are nice and worn. Once I dry brush over the top of these, it'll really subdue it a lot. But I will go with a darker color for the foam underneath the vinyl seats like that, or the leather, whatever you want to say it is. But it does look pretty good. It does crack that up and muss it up, and it is a lot in scale, you know, at the bottom of the headliner where it tears free, and in the seats where each little crack down there rips open. If they were any wider, we'd be talking about a gap in a real-life seat like 5 inches wide. Whereas on this one, it does look pretty in scale with the cracks in the seams there and everything. We've got the engine painted, of course. I did leave this raw metal. I have to weather it up because when you pull that head off, it, of course, is going to leave raw metal. I blacked out the exhaust ports on this one since it doesn't have a manifold. And I'm going to kind of glue it on cockeyed like he was ripping off the manifold and the head. And he couldn't get the intake off, so he just started trying to undo bolts and rip it off sideways. My idea, my backstory for this is that it is a clone Yenko. The guy had a Camaro, tried to make it look like a Yenko, tried to tell everyone, and of course they knew it wasn't a Yenko, but he bought all the stickers for it, and it's got some dents and dings over the years. It's got some misshapen. When you do your dents and dings, put your decals over them, because a decal is going to conform to whatever condition the body is in. We've got our dashboard here. I just have to do some of the chrome trim around it, and then we'll wear it out on the top. The top would be another good place to do some crinkle or vinyl damage effects. I didn't do it on this one, but you can always get to it. We're going to rust out the rear differential. We're going to dry brush and crust the bottom of the vehicle a little bit, touch up the black with just some black paint handed on where I clamped it on. We'll get all that stuff working. We got the wheels and tires. I'm going to experiment and see if I can't flatten two of the tires on this car and see what I can come up with, just guessing around and bebopping on the internet to see what they do. So I will keep working. We will come back for another update. Now that I'm into the build, I'm going to show you some of the stuff I've done. I've covered a lot of how I weather and dry brush in dozens of other reviews. Go ahead, if you see a thumbnail of a weathered vehicle, check out that vehicle on the channel. You'll see more of it. I know I did it on the Deutz D30, on the Ram, on the Ford 65. I do all kind of weathering, so feel free to check those out. Dry brushing is a very easy technique, so I'll just talk about it quick instead of a lot of demonstration, but you need some paper towel or a disposable towel. You need your paints. I use craft paints because they're so easy to use and they're so non-toxic. You don't have to worry about fumes and getting them on your fingers. I use my fingers for a lot of weathering because you can get the perfect burnish without a brush and all that, and dirtying things up. I also like to use things like Tamiya Paneline Accent Color. You can get that stuff at Model Roundup. You can get the craft paints at Walmart, Hobby Lobby, wherever you want to go. I take it, I get a little bit of paint on the brush, I rub most of it off, and then I start brushing the surface very lightly, and paint will come off as you need it to, and focus as you would on a real car, okay? When we do a light gray over the black, that lightens up the surface and brings out detail. Then we do a rust color. We get our rust in there and we pack more dirt into the fender wells, and you can literally pack it in that way. Then we get down by the rear differential, the exhaust, we do some more rust coloring on it. Then we get by the exhaust, we take a metallic, we get a metallic as you can see right there, and we brush a little harder and get, because the tank would be more of a steel, and it would still surface rust like it has, but it wouldn't be as bad as the exhaust, which is raw metal that's being heated up, cooled off over and over again, and completely rotting. Just like the differential, will get a thicker layer of surface rust on it because it's getting warm and all that inside, and that causes corrosion faster. So I also took some yellow paint that's much lighter than the body color, and I dabbed it in there and I brushed it along the edge like when Wilbur He was painting up his car to look like a Yenko because he wanted everyone to think he bought a Yenko car. And so he ended up getting a lot of overspray underneath the car. And God knows how many times this thing's been painted, but he really didn't care. So that's what I wanted to do, was sort of touch up that underneath. And you can see how cool that looks, kind of crusted up and dirtied up. So don't worry about it. Now the interior, exact same techniques. We have the interior together, and it looks phenomenal. We've got our crack front seats. I took a gray and dry brush the dashboard, dry brush the seats to get us that faded vinyl look, and make sure also I dry brush the top of the door panels because those will be exposed to sun just like the dashboard. And we got that, and also leave some gloss in there though, because it never always disappears, it's still there. Then I took some dirt color and went underneath and smushed it into the floor mats, more in the front and less in the back, because how often do you have people in the back seat except for you and your lady on a Saturday night? So we've got it in there. I don't have the headrest on that one. Who knows where that thing went? It got taken off years ago. I dirtied up the shifter after I chromed it out with a silver pen, and we just rubbed it in there. And then our dashboard looks awesome with a little bit of chrome accents. And then we dusted up the back package shelf. Because of the way I want to decorate this, the back package shelf definitely has to be a little dirtier than it would be under the sun. So I really did add some browns with that highlight of the fading. Did a silver pen on the door trim, and just did a little bit of dirt on the door trim, but not a lot because they sit vertical and they're inside the car, so they're not going to get as much damage. But the steering wheel I really wore down from the years of letting it slide through your hands and sitting in the sun. But that looks cool, and I like that cracked seat look now. It looks much more in place, and it looks definitely awesome. The dashboard face itself, I left pretty clean. How dirty does your dashboard get? Honestly, if it's got a windshield in front of it, it just gets a little dusty. I crusted up the firewall and highlighted some of the metallic areas there. That looks good. I also rusted up the exhaust, the missing exhaust, and the drive shaft. That's going to be in the diorama. And because the drive shaft, the ends of the drive shaft would be clean, I painted those silver before I dirtied it up after he slid it out. The wheels and the tires are all done. We got a mix. We've got one of the good, beautiful Goodyear polyglass GTs as it is with a big flat spot on it. How did I do the flat spot? Let's talk about that. I took a lighter. All I did was hold it above that until it was warm, and it was just about, literally almost about to start on fire, and smashed it into my workbench and held it down. Then I did it again a couple times, and you can see how it has flattened itself out. You're never going to see that melted part. You're just going to see that flattened part all the way down like that, like it's lost a lot of its air. It's had some problems, flat spotted. Did the same with the BF Goodrich radials. What I did was, who's going to buy radial TAs without having the white letters out on a Camaro? Come on, you got to have the white letters out. So I took those white letter tires, and I used a white chalk pencil. Right there, this one's called Recollections. Oh, how lovely. And I use that, and then I just rub that on the high point of the tire. And then while I'm dirtying the tire up with dry brushing and getting the back even more filthy, because the rim never gets cleaned on the back, then I ended up rubbing some of the white letters off, and that's exactly what it should look like. A white letter tire that doesn't get maintained will eventually get a lot of scuffs, and the letters will start to come off. And you could even add some white in the flat area of the tire, because as you scrub around those tires and as they get bad, more of the white gets exposed. And then I flatten that tire the exact same way, and we have it all set like that. Then with the tread, you can see that the upper part of the tread is pretty clean while the inner tread's got dirt in it. Pack your paint all the way around, then take your thumb, rub a lot of it off. It's all craft paint, so it's absolutely harmless to you, and we'll wash off with soap and water when we're all done. Then I took my Tamiya black wash and did inside all the rims and tires and made sure. What you want to do when you deform a tire is you don't want to make it so that the tire comes off the rim unless you want that look. Normally, even when a tire's flat, the bead is so tight around that bead ring that it's still going to hold on. It's not going to come loose until it's gotten super old. Then you could kind of deform it like that. But if you do my melting technique with the flame, just kind of hold it up and then smash it into your desk, that will actually get it to flatten out. So we got two flats on one side. We got two just worn out tires, but they still look pretty good. And we got the dirtied up wheels with that black wash and the brake dust and a little bit of dirt to look like corrosion. So that's all set. Now talking about the body. Had some fun with the body. You can see I've done all kinds of dry brushing. I've scratched off the decal in some parts where it's a cheap decal. You know, it comes off. He got it off of eBay. I wanted to make a fake Yenko. He didn't do very good at it. I got the dent. I got some paint coming off above that in the decal. We got all kinds of yellow paint fade all over the car. I used a little gray on the back to fade the black valance. The taillights really aren't going to fade too much. I took a headlight out. That's why I wanted to leave that shiny chrome. Left one in with some dirt, give it some rust and some corrosion on the front bumper. Faded that black front spoiler with a little bit of gray. So we're making it look kind of rusty, crusty. Did my windshield chip. I always like doing that. Take your blade, stick it in, screw it around in a circle, and then drag it backwards in a couple different directions, and your blade is all set. So that is easy enough to do. We've got it rusted up. We've got it crusted up. What I've got to do is add a little rust. What I did for that bottom silver trim, oh, that's real silver trim. Yeah, it is. All the way along the bottom where it conforms with the dent. And on this side where I'm peeling some of it off, because it's coming loose, we're going to end up adding rust effects in a little bit. I took some very cheap aluminum tape available at your hardware store. I got this at a discount store. I got like 150 yards of it for about $3. This is going to last forever doing it in a little trim like this. And then I slowly peeled some of it off. And when I add my rust effects that are coming up next, then those will be added underneath it like this is rotted, rusted, and pitted apart and is pulling off the vehicle. You can pull off as much as you want. You don't have to pull off as too much. You can use bare metal foil for that, but I'm just using a cheap aluminum tape, which is going to look great on there. So we've got all of our details in. We're beating it up. We're crusting it up. I'm going to give it a little bit of a rust along the bottom. You see where I wore it out, where the dent is, to bring it a little detail with dry brushing. Now we'll get to the engine. We're going over a lot of stuff because I've done a lot of work here. I've got it filthied up. You can just see that cylinder hole. My idea for this was he ripped off the manifold. He was able to get that off. He busted off the bolts on the intake, but he still needs this head for his other car. So he's tried to take it off, and he can't get it off, but he knows he still has to use it. So we put the valve cover back on to keep those valves clean underneath. He doesn't really care about the cylinder or anything, but he needs it. Now, this engine is shot. On this side, piston come through or whatever. Let's imagine that it cracked. He pulled the valve. He saw the valves dropped in or whatever. So, but this side he still wants to use. So I glued it on, and then I dry brushed it and filthied it up. Left the rusty manifold on this side. He hasn't touched it. The oil leaks from the cap there. The carburation, the air cleaner, we're just going to throw underneath the hood. But when he wanted to pull that head off, he still wanted to use those valves and everything. The rocker, he wanted the whole head as one piece. So he put the valve cover back on. I kind of like that look, like it's just kind of halfway being worked on. And that's going to look beautiful underneath that hood. So I'm going to come back. I'm going to get the little camera out. We're going to do a little filming of how I'm going to add the rust details by using these little brushes here. And then when we come back after we add the rust, we'll have that. Well, you see what you got there, man. You got yourself, yeah, man, she's a real sweet, man. She's a Yenko. That's not a real Yenko. No, it is, man. I had it for years, man. She's worth a fortune. I'm going to fix her up someday. You know, she's going to be all great and stuff. But that's original. Yeah, that's not an original Yenko. Of course it's not an original Yenko. No one would let it rot like that. Nope. This is a nice little clone that's been worn out and beat up over the years. Now it's sitting in his front yard. It's got two flat tires, and it's kind of just sinking into the landscape. He's got spare parts on the back. We showed you the engine. We'll have more pictures of that at the end of the video. But yeah, she's just kind of rusting and crusting apart. No rear glass. He's got the exhaust and the drive shaft on there. He's got a battery. He's got the manifold. He's got a tire on there. Those are all just extra things from the kit we can throw in the back and make it look like fun. We got the interior beat up and chipped. We got that awesome piece of molding hanging off using cheap aluminum tape. We used a lighter to do some dents, and then we did some dry brushing with craft paints to highlight it. We left the headlight out, so we left the bezel shinier than the other bezel, and of course we beat it up a little bit. Now, no matter which way you decide to build your Yenko, if you want to build it as a beautiful 69 Camaro, you're all set to go. If you want to beat it up, you're all set to go. No matter how you do it, you're still going to end up with all kinds of extra tires. You're going to end up with extra decals, all those nice Yenko stripes you can use on another kit, and other things that I didn't use, like, you know, some of the engine labels and stuff, because it's not a real one. So he's had stick parts in there. We got license plates left. He hasn't had plates on this thing in 15 years. And that decal sheet had that awesome window sticker right there that you definitely want to keep. So I had a lot of fun with this. 2-day build, real easy to do. Give it a nice paint job and then beat it all up. Works fine. You saw how I throw the rust techniques on there. Build it up as you want and have a good time. And don't let anyone tell you you have to make it look a certain way. You saw how I flattened those tires? That seems to work pretty well. I've got to perfect it a little more. I've got to get working on it. Maybe see, you know, cut the tires at some point to shave them down and sink them in. If this was in gravel or grass diorama, it would look even better, because then I could push the car down into it and sink it in. And I showed you how I white lettered those radial TAs. He's got the Goodyears on the front, but he was always burning off the back tires, trying to impress Yvonne at the factory in the office, and she really didn't care because the thing was a rust bucket back then. A fun build, an easy build, and you don't feel bad about beating up an older style kit like this, you know, and it doesn't have a gajillion parts to it, so it doesn't make your build extremely difficult or lengthy. 2 days and you can have something all beat up and worn out like this. I'll have pictures underneath the hood so you can see what I've done under there at the end. As always, thanks to Round 2 Models for sending this over. This kit is available right now at retailers like Model Roundup. There'll be links in the description where you can get yours. Thanks for watching the workshop. Build for you. Have fun and enjoy yourself like I did on this, and practice with new things, learn new techniques. Now I know how to dent fenders and doors and make them look somewhat realistic, like they really would work. So we will see you at the next review.